Well, good afternoon. Welcome to the ACSM European College of Sports Science Exchange Lecture. Well, I also should say, of course, good evening for those living east of Europe, and good morning also to one of our speakers who are living west of Europe. The European College of Sports Science and the American College of Sports Medicine Exchange Lecture has already quite a long tradition. Actually, Carl Foster and I have been organizing this for several years, and we always try to have a program where we have, let's say, important speakers from both Europe and the US and interact on this topic. And this time it's on exercise and health and the molecular aspects of exercise and health. It's held in the US and in Europe at the conferences of the both societies, and we are actually hoping that next year we will again have a physical presence of our speakers on both sides of the ocean. We have two speakers today. The first is Bente Klarlund Pedersen, and the second one is Scott Powers. Bente is, I think, needs no real true introduction, because Bente has a long-standing track record in exercise science, and especially also when it comes to the myokines. She's a professor of integrative medicine and a specialist in infectious disease and internal medicine, and chief physician at Copenhagen University Hospital. She has a quite a long list of publications. I believe it's about more than 700 scientific publications. 700 scientific publications. I was confusing with the 50, more than 50,000 citations, and which is also very impressive. But without further ado, I give the floor to Bente. I also have to ask the audience, you are able to ask questions in the Q&A session in the chat, and after the first talk we'll take a few questions, and also after the second talk, and we might have, if there's enough time, a general discussion at the end, and I'll pick the questions that you pose in the Q&A in the chat. Bente, you have the floor.
Thank you very much, Romain. It is fantastic. It's a fantastic opportunity and a great privilege to have a chance to give a talk at this ACSM-ECSS Exchange Symposium. Thank you very much for your very kind words. My disclosures are that I believe exercise is good for you, and that I'm writing popular science books on exercise and health. Physical inactivity is a major problem. It is also a problem, I think, that we see this polarization in exercise patterns. So at the same time, as many people are extremely active, we see a growing group of people who are extremely physically inactive. And this means a lot to mortality risk. So here we see the very inactive person, here we see the very active, and the most important thing here, I think, is that the arrow points at what you can gain from 30 minutes of moderate to intense exercise daily. A decrease in mortality risk by 30%. We also know that exercise decreases the risk of 35 different diseases and conditions. This is due to a review article by Frank Booth and co-authors. And moreover, evidence exists that exercise has a role in the treatment of many chronic diseases. So exercise is medicine, but we can also use exercise as medicine in the treatment of patients with many different chronic disorders. Typically, these chronic disorders will be associated with chronic inflammation. And if you have one of these disorders, let's say type 2 diabetes, you have a 2 to 3-fold increased risk of having one of the others. If we can combat chronic inflammation, we may also reduce the comorbidity of the patients. exercise mediates anti-inflammation, and I will show you how exercise with each bout of exercise mediates anti-inflammation, and I will show you the long-term effects of exercise, effects on anti-inflammation. So we have been interested and sort of discovered that the muscle produces hundreds of myokines. And among these myokines, some myokines have impact on the inflammatory system. With each bout of exercise, interleukin-6 increases in an exponential fashion, followed by classical anti-inflammatory cytokines with each bout of exercise. And it is a paradox that high resting levels of IL-6 are associated with obesity and physical inactivity. At the same time, as we see that acute exercise induces a marked increase in IL-6. It's important to mention that interleukin-6 can work as a cytokine, as we see it in rheumatoid arthritis, as we see it in sepsis. It can work as an adipokine and as a myokine in relation to exercise. And the signaling pathways from IL-6 in the immune system and skeletal muscle are very different. So while IL-6 provokes pro-inflammatory response in immune cells, this is not the case in muscle cells. It's also important to stress that the circulating IL-6 reflects local TNF production. So when we want to discuss whether exercise induces IL-6, is a bad guy or a good guy, we have had to look for a real bad guy, because all our acute studies on IL-6 seems to show that IL-6 has many health beneficial effects. We looked at TNF. We know that TNF induces IL-6, and when we gave TNF to humans, together with an insulin clamp and glucose traces, we could study the effect of TNF on metabolism. Just as an anecdote, I can tell you that I was the first person who received TNF, and my student gave me 100 times too much, so I was without blood pressure for 3 hours, almost without blood pressure. So it's a very powerful molecule. But the data was quite interesting, because TNF induces skeletal muscle insulin resistance in healthy subjects, and we also had a mechanism, because this is mediated via inhibition of AS160 phosphorylation. AS160 is a key molecule in insulin resistance. So it's interesting that that kind of studies show us that although TNF and IL-6 coexist in disease states, then one molecule inhibits glucose uptake and fat oxidation, whereas the other, IL-6, stimulates glucose uptake and fat oxidation. So we wondered, is it due to the fact that IL-6 could feedback and inhibit TNF? The cytokine pattern to sepsis and exercise have many similarities, but in exercise, interleukin-6 increases without an increase in TNF. We wondered what would happen if we introduced a sepsis-like challenge of the body at a time where this cytokine cascade had been activated. So we used an in vivo model in humans with low-grade inflammation. So we simply infused endotoxin to humans, and we saw this increase in TNF. But when subjects had exercised before, TNF did not increase. And when we infused interleukin-6 to mimic the exercise effect on IL-6, again, we found that TNF did not increase. This told us that acute exercise had anti-inflammatory effects, which might be mediated by interleukin-6. So the acute effects of exercise with regard to anti-inflammation are very strong. We inhibit TNF and we stimulate classic anti-inflammatory cytokines. Coming to the long-term effects, I actually would like to make the opposite paradigm. I would like to show you what relatively short-term physical inactivity can provoke. So we asked healthy young males to decline the daily number of steps from 10,000 to 1,500 steps per day for 14 days. So they should just take the car instead of walking, take the elevator instead of staircase. Fitness level decreased, body weight decreased by 1.2 kilos due to a decrease in fat-free mass. Total fat mass did not change, but when we gave an oral fat tolerance test, blood lipids increased much more, and sometimes plasma became milky because the fat burning capacity of the muscles were severely impaired. When we did an oral glucose tolerance test, we had indications of insulin resistance, and when we then did a euglycemic insulin clamp, it was clear that whole body insulin resistance took place. We also found that physical inactivity reduced insulin-stimulated peripheral glucose uptake due to a decrease in AS160 phosphorylation. Then we did an MR scan and looked at visceral fat mass. And as you can see here, we have the visceral fat before. And after 14 days of declining daily steps, there was a marked increase in the amount of visceral fat. And this fat becomes inflamed and is a source of chronic systemic inflammation. So in relation to this study, my student called this 14 days at Mallorca all-inclusive study, we saw impaired glucose uptake, impaired insulin signaling, hyperlipidemia, loss of muscle mass and fitness, and increased visceral fat mass. And we have many indications that what happens is that this visceral fat become invaded by macrophages, and this is a source of chronic systemic inflammation that can affect, in essence, all cells and organs in the body. So what is the link? How can exercise or physical inactivity impact on visceral fat mass accumulation? And could IL-6 be the link? The reason why we asked that question was that we know that interleukin-6 deficiency causes mature onset obesity in the mice. So we know that the exercise leads to the release of the myokine IL-6, and we simply ask whether this could have impact on visceral fat. So we know that exercise training will typically reduce especially the amount of visceral fat mass. We hypothesized that IL-6 blockade would ameliorate reduction in adipose tissue following exercise training. So we did a study where we asked abdominally obese people to do exercise training for 12 weeks. And we then allocated them into exercise training for 12 weeks plus placebo or plus IL-6 blockade with a drug called tocilizumab. Two other groups did not exercise, but one group received IL-6 blockade. We found no effect of IL-6 blockade alone on visceral fat. We found that exercise training, as expected, decreased or reduced visceral fat mass. But the exercise-induced fat reduction was reversed by IL-6 blockade. So this tells us that IL-6 is required for exercise-mediated reduction in adipose tissue. We also looked at epicardial adipose tissue and found no effect of IL-6 blockade alone on epicardial fat. We found a marked reduction in epicardial fat as a consequence of exercise training, but this was totally abolished by IL-6 blockade. So again, IL-6 signaling is also required for epicardial fat loss following exercise. In addition, we found that exercise-induced IL-6 delays gastric emptying in humans and thereby led to a decrease in postprandial glucose and postprandial insulin. Back to our myokine model here. To summarize this first part, acute anti-inflammatory effects of exercise is mediated by an effect on TNF, IL-10 and IL-1RA. And long-term anti-inflammatory effects of exercise training is mediated by a reduction of visceral fat mass. So exercise has these very strong anti-inflammatory effects. And this has become extremely interesting during the COVID-19 period here, because we know that COVID-19 can induce a cytokine storm, an inflammatory storm. We know that some people hardly get sick, and some people end in hospital, maybe in the intensive care unit, or maybe they die. We know that inflammation is a double-edged sword. We know that, of course, when you get COVID-19, you have to produce inflammation, but it's equally important that you can downregulate the inflammation. If not, then we will see this picture that the COVID-19 infection is caused by a storm of inflammation in the lungs, leading to a very severe disease. We also know that severe COVID-19 infection is in particular seen in patients with chronic inflammation, and we know that patients with chronic inflammation has an impaired ability to provoke an anti-inflammatory response following an acute inflammation, so they can increase the inflammatory response, but they cannot downregulate it again. On the other hand, as I just said, regular physical activity will induce anti-inflammation, and thereby it could decrease the risk of severe COVID-19 infection. And this was exactly what was shown by Bob Salis, or to say it the other way around, that physical inactivity is linked to more severe COVID-19 infection and death. This has recently been highly discussed because it's such an important finding. Okay, one more thing. In relation to this 14 days of inactivity study, something else happened. It's so that the two of the subjects were my own sons. I have to do this when I cannot get permission from the ethical committee. It's just... Okay, so I realized that they became annoyed and depressed, and then we repeated the study, but now we collaborated with neurobiologists and found that the cognitive function, the ability to focus and concentrate, decreased in relation to these 14 days. This is interesting. We know also that sedentary behavior is associated with cognitive impairment. We know that physical activity decreases the risk of dementia. This is just one study. Moderate exercise decreased risk of dementia. More intense exercise, massive decrease in dementia. So exercise can also lower the rate of cognitive decline in patients with neurodegenerative disorders and in healthy people of all ages. Exercise can decrease the risk of stress, anxiety, and depression. A positive correlation between fitness and cognitive function in the elderly have been shown in several studies. So what is the mediator? Most people look at brain-derived neurotrophic factor. BDNF is a growth factor for hippocampus, and we know that when mice run, BDNF is upregulated in the brain. And in our own studies, we find looking at AV differences across the brain, that BDNF is upregulated when the test person is doing muscle work in bed. Some studies show that hippocampus volume increases with exercise. So, but how can muscle signal to the brain so that the brain will produce BDNF? This has been shown in a couple of studies how this is possible. It starts with irisin, the myokine discovered by Spiegelman's group. And later, this molecule, also called PDC1, FNDC5, was shown to activate BDNF in the brain. Another very important study is by Henriette van Braak's group, who showed that running induced systemic cathepsin B, and cathepsin B that is also a newly identified myokine by this group, is associated with memory function. And I summarized it here in the publication that these two myokines, they are released by the muscle and pass the blood-brain barrier, stimulate BDNF, which leads to hippocampal neurogenesis and in enhanced learning, memory, and mood. I think it's so fascinating that we now have this molecular link between muscle and brain, which totally make us understand why so many philosophers found that they had to walk or do exercise in order to think properly. Really, Nietzsche said, all truly great thoughts are conceived by walking. And the Danish philosopher Søren Kierkegaard said, I have walked myself into my best thoughts, and I know of no thought so burdensome that one can't walk away from it. Okay, in our own center, we are very interested in exercise and health as a translational perspective, so I have given you some more mechanistic background, but I would like to share the two translational studies that we have done, one in cancer and one in diabetes. So first cancer. The protective effect of exercise has been shown in many studies. In this huge study with 1.44 million people, it was shown that exercise decreases the risk of 13 different cancers. We also know that exercise increases survival after a cancer diagnosis in breast cancer, prostate cancer, and colon cancer. Pernille Højmann, who unfortunately and very sadly died, did groundbreaking research at a young age. She worked as a group leader in our center. She had mice who were in a box, and mice who had access to a wheel, and she gave them a malignant melanoma, and you can see the lungs here, or the black spots are the cancer. The mice who had access to a wheel had a markedly reduced cancer burden. Marked reductions in tumor incidence and growth with volunteer wheel running across 9 different tumor models were found. In this study, we took the cancer here and did a lot of molecular stuff and found that immune function and inflammation was upregulated in the cancer cells from the exercising mice. Especially natural killer cells were upregulated, and when we depleted NK cells, we saw that the tumor volume increased and there was no longer an effect of exercise. We also saw in mice, athymic mice who have no T cells but NK cells, that they had maintained a significant exercise effect on tumor growth. So it's not the T cells, it's supposed that it is the NK cells that are doing the work. We knew from older studies that natural killer cells are recruited through the blood during exercise and then disappears. And we know that epinephrine is involved in the beginning and that IL-6 may be involved here. So we did a lot of studies showing that, for instance, beta blockade during exercise blunted the exercise-dependent reduction in tumor growth and blunted the effect on NK cell infiltration. We did a lot of studies also with IL-6. I think it all took 5 years, but the conclusion was that in relation to exercise, epinephrine increases and mobilizes natural killer cells to the blood, which are then redistributed by IL-6 into tumor. We know from our ongoing studies that cancer patients show a large extent of NK cell mobilization during exercise. So they can mobilize NK cells. And in this study with GEDA cancer, we have preliminary data showing that exercise training increases the number of patients reaching tumor resection. Exercise training reduces the number of patients who are hospitalized during chemotherapy, and exercise training reduces the toxicities to chemotherapy. We are now doing a quite big study. It's ongoing, but we have a big randomized study, and of course we hope to see that exercise training that patient can benefit from that. This is a translational study with translation research infrastructure where we include a lot of municipalities. So if we have a positive outcome of this study, we have already established a structure for implementation. And then I will give you a little story about type 2 diabetes. In our country, in Denmark, there has been a very, very popular TV program with a very charismatic coach called Chris McDonald. And he invited people who were obese or had type 2 diabetes to take part in the television program. And after half a year or so, they were all lean and they had no disease anymore, and they were very happy. So we wondered, what if we excluded the TV camera, and what if we did not have a charismatic coach, but if we had just a clinical setting would we be able to see the same in normal patients with type 2 diabetes? So we adopted the intervention from that has been done in TB and took it into a classical randomized controlled study. And this was led by Mathias Ritt-Larsen and Mette Juhl-Johansen. So we had the patients with T2 diabetes. They were not on insulin, but they had only had type 2 diabetes for 10 years or less. We initially adjusted their treatment for 6 to 12 weeks, so they were really, really well regulated, and randomized them into a 2-to-1 fashion, 64 patients here and 34 patients here. And in this group, patients received supervised exercise training 60 minutes, 6 times per week. And in the beginning, it was supervised, and then it was only partially supervised. They also had some instruction by a dietitian. I'll just give you one example from this study. But if we looked into the intervention group, after 1 year of this lifestyle intervention, 74% could reduce their medication, and 56% was without any glucose-lowering medication. This is pretty interesting. We also found that the dose response effect of exercise and glucose lowering medication for type 2 diabetes was there. So if the patients took the high dose, all the dose, then a number needed to treat was only 2. If they did not really adhere to the training sessions, number needed to treat was 4. So we saw marked effects on important risk factors in the groups who took the highest dose of exercise. Recent data suggest that intensive lifestyle intervention with high volume exercise, as just shown here, has the potential to improve beta cell function, and that this is associated with decreased abdominal adiposity and thereby low grade inflammation. Okay, so what I wanted to point out today is that the past 20 years has given us maybe a new way to look at the muscle. The muscle is a very metabolic organ. It secretes hundreds of molecules, so-called myokines, whereby muscle can communicate with other organs such as the brain, the bone, the liver, the pancreas, the gastrointestinal tract, and the immune system. It can also communicate to the fat and contribute to switch fat into a more browning phenotype. What I also wanted to stress here again is that thereby muscle can induce working muscle can induce strong anti-inflammatory effects, and we believe that this is one of several mechanisms whereby exercise can mediate its effect as medicine. I'm a true believer in translational medicine, and I'm very happy that we have a research center where there are a lot of people who have very different expertises. And I'm totally grateful that I can work with them. And today I want to highlight the important work by 4 of our group leaders, Helga Ellingsgaard, Rikke Krogh Madsen, Jesper Frank Christensen, and Mathias Ruth Larsen. And I want to thank the many people that I'm so happy to work with on a daily basis. Thank you.
Thank you, Ben. We have plenty of time for questions and answers. I didn't see that any appeared during the talk, but I urge you to put some questions in the chat function so that we can have a conversation with Bente. I was impressed, Bente, by this overview. Of course, the myokines, long time ago already, we can say that, well, IL-6 was something mysterious, but it seems that it still stands there and we're getting deeper and deeper into the function of IL-6. I was also, of course, interested in the communication between muscle and brain. And of course, Most of the studies performed are endurance studies, and then the link with the brain and BDNF, which is most of the time linked with CREB. But have you also an idea on the effect of resistance training and its effect on the same system?
So most of the studies on muscle brain crosstalk has been done in murine models, and it is typically running exercise, or actually the studies on cathepsin B by Henriette van Praagh's group has also been shown in monkeys, and so but it is typically treadmill running, so there's very little knowledge about resistance exercise. When it comes to IL-6, we have our own studies showing that it seems that it's always difficult to compare aerobic exercise and strength training. But if you compare progressive training and the same amount of time, then the IL-6 response are similar.
Yeah, because if you translate that kind of exercise, I think in elderly, of course, endurance exercise is very important for their, let's call it, general physical condition. But of course, let's call it strength training is also good for, well, balance and muscle strength.
And elderly, but we also, I mean, in our cancer program, we use a mixed model, so we do both aerobic and resistance training, and that's because there are very solid evidence that loss of muscle mass is a severe prognostic sign. So simply based on that, we taking these patients in, we want to do both. And of course, I cannot say yes that this is a holy grail, but it seems that they do better. And I mean, there are other mechanisms than muscle as a secretory organ. There are other mechanisms whereby exercise can do good, but it seems that it is the amount of muscle mass that are engaged in the exercise and the duration and the intensity that matters. It's not so much whether it is aerobic or resistance exercise.
So this is a very important general message, actually, for the general population. We still have some time, so I don't see any questions appear in the chat, so allow me to ask another question.
I'm sorry, I thought I had too much slides, but it didn't take 40 minutes, so.
No, but it's okay. I'll just looking at the time so that we can start the next talk more or less on time. But of course, I suggest, or I think, that in most of your experimental studies, you also control for diet, but in true life, I think some people exercise. They are convinced that they need to exercise more, and well, they probably have a good meal and some alcohol afterwards. This is the real life situation. What if that combination still exists? Do you think it would be influenced also, or influencing the results?
Definitely, at least carbohydrate loading and muscle glycogen are very, very determining factors. So there are a lot of studies there, for instance, by David Niemann's group, and we've done some also. So we know that if muscle glycogen is slow, then the myokine release is much stronger. And we also know that if you consume carbohydrate, glucose drinks, sports drinks during the exercise, then you dampen on an mRNA level and on the protein level the production of these myokines. So I think that the most efficient outcome of your training will be actually to not consume a lot of sugar during training. When you compete, you can do whatever you like, but in the training session, then let's take it to normal people, patients or healthy people. I think, I mean, it would be the same mechanisms of actions, and it's definitely better to eat after the exercise than to take in a lot of a lot of food before, if what you want to obtain is efficient training adaptation. Does that make sense?
I totally agree, because of course we know that there's a lot of let's say high carbohydrate drinks and sport drinks on the market, but I think that is for the Formula One racers, meaning
if you want to do a marathon, of course you have to consume sugar, but if you want to train for a marathon, I'm not so sure that you shouldn't do that on water.
Okay, thank you. If there are no other questions from the audience, I think we can switch to our second speaker. Thank you, Bente. This was a very inspiring talk, as always, I would say, and thank you for giving this nice lecture. Now we go to our second speaker, and that is Scott Powers. Scott is distinguished scholar of the health sciences at Stetson University. Dr. Powers' research is focused on the effect of exercise and inactivity on the health of both cardiac and skeletal muscles. I think we here have a good example of a professor whose research has resulted in quite some exciting results. He also published more than 260 peer-reviewed. He's former vice president of ACSM. He got recently honor award at the ACSM, and he's also, what I was told, a very good teacher. So I'm really looking forward to your talk.
So Romain, thank you very much for that kind introduction. And if I can have my first slide, please. Okay. Well, I'm honored to take part in this ACSM European College of Sports Science Exchange. I'm disappointed I have to follow an outstanding scientist and speaker like Dr. Peterson, but nonetheless, this is the short straw that I got today. So thanks to the organizing committee for allowing me to take part. So the story I'm going to tell you today is a story about exercise preconditioning in both cardiac and skeletal muscle myocytes. So here's a roadmap of where I'm going to take you over the next 35 or 40 minutes. For those of you that are new to the field, I'm going to introduce the rapid evolution of our understanding about what exercise does to myocytes, cardiac and skeletal. The bulk of my talk, though, is going to focus on two topics that I've been very fascinated about, and that is the mechanisms responsible for exercise-induced cardioprotection. And over the last 20 years, a big focus in my laboratory has been to try to understand why prolonged inactivity results in rapid wasting of inspiratory muscles, in particular the diaphragm, and how we've used exercise training as a model to try to understand how we can develop therapeutic approaches that can actually be used in the clinic. So with that big picture introduction of where we're going, let's get started. Well, I don't need to tell this audience that cardiac and skeletal muscle fibers are very plastic and they adapt rapidly to exercise training. We've actually known this for almost 50 years, but what we haven't known actually is what goes up and what happens when this adaptation takes place. So what you see here is what I call a plot of research progress in this area. And these are studies that dealt with either exercise-induced adaptations in cardiac or skeletal muscle fibers. And if you look at this histogram, you can see that most of what we know has accrued over the last two decades. And in fact, in 2020, there was a remarkable number of papers published, 7,226 papers. I can't confess to having read all of those papers, but it just gives you an idea of the explosion of the interest in this field. So let's shift this interest toward the topic of exercise-induced cardioprotection. So I don't need to tell this audience that myocardial ischemia reperfusion injury is the leading cause of both morbidity and mortality that's associated with coronary artery disease. This continues to be a worldwide problem. These are data from the World Health Organization indicating that cardiovascular disease remains a leading cause of death worldwide. It's about 32% of all deaths are due to cardiovascular disease. And last year, it was estimated that about 18 million deaths occurred due to some manifestation of cardiovascular disease. And clearly, the key to survival and recovery from a heart attack is to minimize the cardiac damage that occurs during the ischemia reperfusion event. So today, when I use the term cardioprotection, what I'm referring to is protecting the heart against ischemia reperfusion injury. So for those of you that don't study IR injury, let me give you a brief synopsis of some of the key events that take place in the cardiac myocyte during ischemia and reperfusion that contribute to the injury. Well, of course, this all starts with a blockage of a coronary vessel. Most of the time, this is a thrombotic event. This blockage, of course, reduces blood flow downstream, creating what's referred to as a risk area, that is a risk of damage to these downstream cardiac myocytes. During ischemia, a number of events take place that can be damaging to the cell. Even though there's a reduction in oxygen, there's a small increase in radical production. There's an increase in cellular free calcium. This activates the calcium activated protease, calpain. Because of the increased glycolytic flux and the lack of oxygen to produce ATP, ATP levels go down, hydrogen ion concentrations go up. So clearly, in order to salvage these cardiac myocytes that are ischemic, the tissue has to be reperfused. When the clot starts to break down, blood flow is restored. This reperfusion, ironically, exacerbates this problem. Certainly, within the first 1 to 10 minutes of reperfusion, there is a large increase in radical production. There's a greater calcium overload, a further activation of calpain, and an activation of caspase 3, leading to apoptotic cell death. So collectively, these disturbances that occur during ischemia and reperfusion contribute to cardiac myocyte injury or death. And critical to this process is mitochondrial damage. It's thought that mitochondria are actually the arbitrators of life and death of the cardiac myocyte during ischemia reperfusion challenge. That is, not only do mitochondria determine whether or not the cell is going to survive, they determine the course of death for the cell, that is, by apoptosis or necrosis. So clearly, protecting mitochondria during an ischemia reperfusion insult appears to be extremely important in having a good outcome. So what determines the level of ischemia reperfusion injury? Well, it appears to be directly proportional to the duration of the ischemic insult. For example, the ischemic insult is 5 minutes or less. This can contribute the possibility of life-threatening arrhythmias, but there is no frank infarction. If the ischemic insult is extended beyond 5 minutes, up to about 20 minutes, there again is no cell death, no frank infarction, but the risk of life-threatening arrhythmias certainly exists. And there is damage to the cardiac myocyte, resulting in an inability to generate force. We call this myocardial stunning. But fortunately, this resolves in 24 to 48 hours after the IR insult. Where the real problem begins is when the ischemic duration is 20 minutes and beyond. This results in frank infarction, a loss of cardiac myocytes, and of course, an overall loss of cardiac function post-MI. So I think we're all aware of the fact that human epidemiological studies suggest that not only does exercise reduce the risk of having a heart attack, it actually increases the possibility of surviving the heart attack, that exercise is cardioprotective. These human studies don't demonstrate directly cause and effect. Many people that engage in regular exercise also adopt other good health behaviors that may be factors that contribute to the cardioprotection. It actually takes animal studies, preclinical studies, to demonstrate directly whether or not exercise alone is cardioprotective. The most common model to study this has been rodent models, and the rat has been the primary model. There have been a variety of studies using endurance exercise. This can be voluntary wheel running, forced treadmill running, and swimming. We've got a handful of resistance exercise studies. And so what I'd like to show you is some of the evidence that indicates that exercise is indeed a key promoter of cardiac protection. Here's a very old study from our laboratory done in the late 90s. We exercise trained animals for 10 weeks, they ran on a treadmill 5 days a week at about 60% of their VO2 max. This was a myocardial stunning study where the heart was exposed to 20 minutes of ischemia. The dependent measure here indicating the level of damage was left ventricular developed pressure before and after the ischemic insult. And you can see that in sedentary animals, there was a marked decline in left ventricular developed pressure from 100% down to a 65% level. These animals that engaged in 10 weeks of endurance training had remarkable protection. And not only were they protected against myocardial stunning, they were protected against life-threatening arrhythmias. 3 years later, we discovered it doesn't take 10 weeks of exercise training. This was quite surprising at the time. Many people didn't believe these results. But since this original paper, a number of studies have demonstrated that even 1 day of exercise provides some degree of protection, and certainly 3 to 5 days of consecutive endurance exercise is very cardioprotective. So what about a more severe ischemic insult, one lasting 60 minutes? Well, here's an old study from our laboratory as well demonstrating that just 5 days of endurance training reduces the level of infarction tremendously compared to a sedentary control. So in this experiment, animals were exposed to 60 minutes of ischemia, followed by 2 hours of reperfusion. What you see here is photographs of the left ventricle of the ventricle itself of the rat. The dark areas represent the area that were not at risk, and the remaining white and red areas represent the risk area. The white tissue is infarcted, but red tissue is viable tissue. And just glancing at these photographs give you the impression, of course, that the exercise trained animals were very much protected. And in fact, if you look at the infarction percent of the area at risk that was infarcted, in the sedentary animal, 60% of the area was infarcted, a major infarct. Leading, if these animals survived, this would lead, of course, to heart failure eventually. Contrast this to the exercise training, about 20% of the risk area infarcted. There's more good news. The IR-induced arrhythmias were also diminished. This is critical because most people die from acute myocardial infarction due to ventricular fibrillation. So reducing the incidence of defib is extremely important. Well, like most things in exercise, we find that it doesn't last, the protection and the benefit, if you stop exercising. So here was a very simple study that Shannon Lennon did in our laboratory where she exercise trained animals for 5 days. 1 day, 3 day, 9 days, or 18 days after they stopped training, she exposed them to an ischemia reperfusion insult. What you see here is that the heart was protected up until 9 days of detraining, even though the protection appears to be waning at 9 days, it was still significantly higher than those of a sedentary animal. But somewhere between day 9 and day 18, all of this cardioprotection is lost. The old adage, use it or lose it, certainly applies to cardioprotection. So the intriguing question now becomes, what's the mechanism? Explain exercise-induced cardioprotection. So let's look at a big picture of the biology of the cardioprotective phenotype. On one hand, exercise can result in vascular changes that could provide cardioprotection. These could be anatomical, increased collateral vessels, or it could be changes in endothelial function, allowing a more rapid reperfusion. There is also really very, very powerful evidence to indicate that there are intrinsic changes in the cardiac myocyte themselves. That is, if you exercise train animals, isolate cardiac myocytes from the left ventricle, expose these in culture, these cardiac myocytes in culture, to hypoxia, reoxygenation, they are protected, independent of vascular changes. So our interest has been to try to understand what exercise does to the cardiac myocyte to provide these intrinsic protective measures. Well, here's a cartoon that I call All of the Usual Suspects. All of this family of molecules or molecules shown here have been shown in one experimental model or another to be cardioprotective. Time won't allow me to go through each of these and show you the evidence both for and against. So I'm going to give you an abbreviated story this afternoon. The story is that I don't believe that exercise-induced changes in endoplasmic reticular stress proteins is essential to achieve exercise-induced cardioprotection. And while it's very clear that an overexpression of heat shock protein 72 can protect cardiac myocytes during ischemia reperfusion, I don't think this is required in exercise. I say that because studies have shown that if you block the increased expression of exercise-induced increases in HSP72, you still achieve cardioprotection. Nor do I believe that an increase in cyclooxygenase 2 is critical for exercise-induced cardioprotection. On the other hand, there is growing evidence that the cargo contained in extracellular vesicles in response to exercise does indeed contribute to cardioprotection. There's also some evidence to suggest that sarcolemma or mitochondrial potassium ATP sensitive channels play a role in this protection. There's also evidence that stimulation of opioid receptors, in particular the delta isoform, contributes likely through the sarcolemmal potassium ATP channel, but it does contribute to cardioprotection. And I think there's really impressive evidence to suggest that altered mitochondrial phenotype plays an important role in exercise-induced cardioprotection. So what I'd like to do now is to show you some evidence about the fact that altered mitochondrial phenotype does indeed contribute, and some of the new evidence suggesting that extracellular vesicles play a role as a mechanism to explain exercise-induced cardioprotection. Well, here's a cartoon from a review that we published 7 years ago now. It basically just conveys the idea that exercise training results in an altered mitochondrial turnover and phenotype that may be resistant to IR injury. And one of the key players in this process is superoxide dismutase 2. So one of our early studies to investigate this was to, the strategy was to try to prevent exercise-induced increase in SOD2 to determine whether or not this was absolutely essential for cardioprotection. Our strategy was to exercise train animals using an antisense oligonucleotide targeted to SOD2 to prevent the exercise-induced increase. You can see from this histogram that exercise typically increases SOD2 activity or protein abundance, but somewhere between 10 to 20% in the mitochondria inside the cardiac myocyte. We were successful in preventing this increase. When we then exposed these animals to an ischemia reperfusion insult, that is 60 minutes of ischemia, followed by 2 hours of reperfusion, you can see that compared to the sedentary animals, the exercise-trained animals with no intervention had remarkable protection. The exercise-trained animals where we prevented the increased expression of SOD2 were also protected, but they lost a significant amount of protection, indicating, of course, that SOD2 is part of the story, but it may be simply one link in the chain and not the entire story. So this brings us to a whole new era of studying exercise-induced cardioprotection. And this introduces the idea of the possibility that exercise increased extracellular vesicles and their cargo contributes to a wide variety of adaptive changes in organs throughout the body in response to exercise. This is a cartoon taken from a recent review that I highly recommend if you haven't read it, but it simply makes the point that the exercise stimulus increases the circulating levels of extracellular vesicles. There are a number of potential cell types that may package and release these vesicles, including endothelial cells and myocytes. Once released into the circulation, these extracellular vesicles and their cargo then have the potential to be taken up in cells throughout the body and exert influences. There's a wide range of cargo that has been identified, and these studies appear every day. They contain heat shock proteins, NRF2, microRNA, and a number of other proteins that might contribute to cardioprotection. This is a relatively new field that actually got a big boost in 2015. This is a study, the first that I can find, that demonstrates that plasma exosomes can indeed protect the myocardium from ischemia reperfusion injury. Spoiler alert, this is not an exercise study. This is a study that actually looked at the mechanism of remote ischemic preconditioning. They tested the hypothesis that the remote ischemic preconditioning that protects the heart against IR injury might be due to exosomes. The conclusion, yes, this is likely the possibility. Well, in the last 4 years, there have been three what I consider to be well-designed studies that have investigated the role of exosomal vesicles contributing to cardioprotection. What's interesting is that the conclusion of all of these studies was that exercise-induced increases in circulating extracellular vesicles do indeed protect against cardiac ischemia reperfusion injury. But each of the studies concluded that the cargo that provided the protection was different. So this cartoon puts all of this together. In one study, they argued that microRNA 342-5P was protected by reducing the activation of caspase 9, signaling through jump 2, resulting in an anti-apoptotic effect. They also postulated that phosphorylation of AKT, resulting in a pro-survival mode in the cell, was protected. Another study argued that without the transmission of NRF2 and its antioxidant effect on cells, the cardioprotection was lost. And then finally, the last study indicated that ERK and HSP72 phosphorylation and signaling was critical for the cardioprotection as part of the cargo in the extracellular vesicle. So we're now in a very exciting time in the study, I think, to try to understand whether or not each of these particular message pathways work independent or in cooperation with each other to produce the cardioprotection. So let me summarize the major points for this part of the talk. First is that it's very clear that exercise-induced cardioprotection is achieved very quickly. 3 to 5 days of endurance exercise provides significant protection. But this protection is lost during detraining. Like most of what we know about the exercise training effects, they don't last forever. And at this point, I think it's safe to say that it's likely that this exercise-induced cardioprotection is due to multiple adaptations in the cardiac myocyte. Clearly, mitochondrial changes play a role. HSPs may play a role in some cases, 72 and 27. Opioid receptors may contribute. And of course, this new exciting chapter of extracellular vesicle-related signaling. So I leave you with this thought, with this section, that I believe that exercise is a powerful investigative tool to discover therapeutic interventions that can be used clinically, that translational studies can follow, that can be used to try to protect against ischemia reperfusion injury. So let me shift to the last chapter in my talk today. What I'd like to talk to you about now is my interest in this problem of ventilator-induced diaphragm dysfunction and how we've used exercise studies to try to develop a therapeutic approach to protect against this. Everybody in this audience is aware that there are many human conditions that result in muscle disuse and muscle atrophy. What you may not be as aware of is the fact that prolonged mechanical ventilation in a mode that renders inspiratory muscles inactive results in a very rapid development of diaphragmatic dysfunction. The first preclinical study to report this appeared in the literature in 1994. I read this paper actually a couple of years after it was published. I had trouble believing it. I was suspicious. I thought that their animals were likely septic. And so we were studying sepsis and not just inactivity, because these investigators reported that just 48 hours of prolonged mechanical ventilation resulted in a 50% reduction in diaphragmatic maximal specific force production and a 50% reduction in fiber cross-sectional area. This seemed very unlikely to me. After a few preliminary experiments in my laboratory, I found that no, indeed, this was the case. So why are we interested in this problem? Well, of course, a great deal of popular information has been put out about the intervention of mechanical ventilation during the COVID-19 pandemic. And clearly, mechanical ventilation is a life-saving intervention for patients in respiratory failure. But unfortunately, an unintended side effect is a problem that has been labeled ventilator-induced diaphragm dysfunction. During prolonged mechanical ventilation, the principal inspiratory muscle in humans and all mammals, the diaphragm, remains inactive. This results in a remarkable level of atrophy and contractile dysfunction. Now, this is significant because diaphragm weakness is predicted to be a primary cause of difficult weaning. In fact, if you look at failure to wean, that is as defined by the inability to separate the patient from the ventilator with the initial attempt, about one third of all patients exposed to more than 48 hours of prolonged mechanical ventilation experience difficulty weaning. This results in an increased stay in the ICU, of course, increased morbidity and mortality. So understanding this problem, what causes it, and developing therapy against it is critical. This is difficult to study in humans, of course, from a mechanistic perspective. So it requires a preclinical model of mechanical ventilation. This cartoon illustrates our approach to the problem. This is a rat anesthetized to a surgical plane of anesthesia. They're intubated with a neonatal human ventilator. There's an arterial line so we can measure blood gases to maintain blood gas homeostasis. And our goal is to mimic in this rodent ICU model what occurs in the human ICU. So let's look at how quickly this problem develops. This is one of our early studies that looks at the time course of the contractile dysfunction in the diaphragm in response to mechanical ventilation. So this is a force frequency curve. The y-axis is the specific force production of diaphragm strips. The x-axis, of course, is the stimulation frequency. And so you can see the top curve is the diaphragm force function curve from control. And you can see the maximum specific force is about 25 newtons per centimeter squared. These family of curves represent 12, 18, and 24 hours of mechanical ventilation. The take-home message here is that you can see that as little as 12 hours of prolonged mechanical ventilation results in a downward and right shift of the force frequency curve. And in fact, within as little as 24 hours, there is about a 50% reduction in specific force production. Well, there's more bad news. Not only is there contractile dysfunction, there's atrophy. And this is, again, is an early study. This is 18 hours of mechanical ventilation. And what this demonstrates is that in 18 hours of prolonged mechanical ventilation, that all fiber types in the rat diaphragm atrophy between 10 to 20%. And what's interesting is that in these same animals, and these animals are in dorsal recumbency in a surgical plane of anesthesia, so the hind limb muscles are also inactive, but there is no detectable atrophy in the soleus muscle during this 18 hours, indicating, of course, that this rate of atrophy is very unique in the diaphragm. So you're probably thinking, okay, this may happen in rodents. There are many studies that show this, but does this occur in human beings? That's a great question. Glad you asked. So in the early 2000s, we realized, of course, that in order for this work to be important, we had to know whether or not this occurs in humans. This proved to be a challenging question, how to answer it. So I paired with Sandy Levine at the University of Pennsylvania in 2003. We wrote a grant, got funded, and 5 years later, we published this paper in the New England Journal that demonstrated that prolonged mechanical ventilation does indeed result in rapid diaphragmatic atrophy in humans. Since this study, there have been numerous studies in humans with a variety of different approaches, including ultrasound, and they've consistently confirmed that prolonged mechanical ventilation results in rapid atrophy and dysfunction of diaphragm fibers in humans. So now the question becomes, how come? Why does this happen so rapidly? Well, obviously, all forms of diaphragmatic atrophy result from the algebraic sum of the rates of protein synthesis versus the rates of proteolysis. In many kinds of atrophy, there is, of course, a depression in protein synthesis and an accelerated proteolysis. This is true in the diaphragm during prolonged mechanical ventilation. But because of the rapidity of the atrophy, it appears clear that proteolysis plays a really critical role early in this process. What's also important is that this whole process appears to be triggered early on by disturbance in redox signaling, an increase in production of reactive oxygen species, primarily coming from mitochondria, but there are other sources as well. This serves as a trigger to activate proteases and to trigger a depression in protein synthesis. So how do we protect against this? Well, we've done preclinical studies with a variety of antioxidant molecules. Some are effective, some are not. Many of them have off-target effects, and none of the molecules we studied are approved by the FDA. We've also used a host of protease inhibitors. Some are effective, some are not. All have off-target effects that are undesirable. None of these molecules are FDA approved. So, in our quest for additional experimental tools, we decided to turn to exercise again. Ask the question, does exercise protect against ventilator-induced diaphragm dysfunction? And then by investigating the mechanisms of why exercise protects, we hope to develop a therapeutic intervention. So first of all, why would we expect exercise training, endurance exercise training, to provide protection? Well, here's a cartoon of the well-known benefits of exercise training on skeletal muscle. We know that it increases the antioxidant capacity. We know that it has a very positive influence on mitochondrial function, improving both the quality and quantity of mitochondria. And we also know that exercise training results in an increased expression of heat shock protein 72 in skeletal muscle. Now, this has been shown to protect against inactivity-induced wasting in limb muscle by specifically blocking FOXO3A signaling, NF-kappa-B signaling, which is involved in the atrogene expression protein to increase protein degradation. So there are several possibilities as to why exercise might protect. So we did a simple study asking the question, can exercise protect? The short answer is yes. There's a study done by Ashley Smooter in our lab, 2012, that simply demonstrates that 2 weeks of exercise training, 10 days of exercise, 5 days for each of Monday through Friday for 2 weeks, resulted in significant protection against the atrophy. So we then set out to determine why is this the case? And what are the mechanisms to explain exercise-induced protection? Our first step, of course, was to do a large-scale proteomic study to look at chondral proteins that changed in the diaphragm in response to our training program and soluble proteins as well. We then developed a list of candidates that we thought that we would screen first in terms of trying to understand this. Our first target, based on our previous experiments in the heart, was to target whether or not the increase in superoxide dismutase 2 antioxidant found inside the mitochondrial matrix that removes superoxide radicals. Is this critical to the protection? We used the approach that we'd used previously in the heart, and that is that we treated animals with a senescence oligonucleotide to prevent the exercise-induced increase in SMD2. And our study demonstrated that prevention of this exercise-induced increase in SMD2 did indeed diminish the protection, but there was still significant protection there. So we decided we would take the approach, independent of exercise, to simply overexpress SOD2 using a transgene overexpression in the diaphragm, and to determine whether this protected against mechanical ventilation-induced atrophy and contractile dysfunction. Our experiments demonstrated very limited protection, indicating that this is maybe part of the problem, part of the story, but not the whole story. We then turned our focus to the question of whether or not HSP72 plays an important role. We targeted this because of the previous studies in limb muscle, suggesting that with transgenic overexpression, muscles were protected against inactivity-induced atrophy. We used an identical approach to the SOD experiments, that is, we treated animals with an antisense oligonucleotide to prevent the exercise-induced increase. And what we found was that when we prevented the exercise-induced increase in the expression of HSP72, all of the protection was lost. We then came back, used a transgenic overexpression of HSP72 in the diaphragm. All of the protection was replaced, just as protected as the exercise story. We then did the logical next experiment. We used a pharmacological mediated expression of exercise-induced increase in HSP72. We also found that the diaphragm was protected. So let me summarize the take-home messages from this part of the story. Clearly, it appears that increased levels of HSP72 play a really important role in the exercise-induced protection, and that simply independent of exercise, transgen overexpression of HSP72 is sufficient to protect. And that this suggests to us that a therapeutic intervention that might be successful would be to target pharmacologically the increased expression of HSP72. So let me leave you with three take-home messages. First, it's clear that endurance exercise training promotes the expression of numerous cardiac and skeletal muscle proteins that result in a protected phenotype. And I want to make the case again that I believe that exercise is a valuable experimental tool to identify biological targets that may lead to therapeutic interventions to protect both cardiac and skeletal muscle against disease conditions that promote muscle wasting. If you don't remember anything else that I said today, please remember this. I believe that exercise is good for you. So I'd like to acknowledge the funding agencies that have supported my work over the last three decades. Too many names to mention of the people that have contributed, but I'm so grateful to the host of outstanding postdocs and graduate students and colleagues that have contributed to this work that you've seen today. And I would be very remiss if I did not acknowledge and thank all of you for your attention. It's a great honor to be here. Thank you for the invitation.
Thank you, Scott, for this impressive talk. I still urge people to put some questions in the chat. I see we have one from Fabian Grossman, actually, to both of the speakers, and it's a very interesting one, because the last sentence of Scott was exercise is good for you, but the question is there a limit where sports becomes a risk factor, and if can we do too much exercise?
I think that question is for Binta.
Is it possible for me to share again?
Yes, sure.
I need to have permission to share. Yeah, thank you. Let me see. I have it here. So I saw it. So I think this is a type of studies that we have seen over the years, that there are may be a J-formed relationship, so that you may, so this is a increasing amount of exercise training. And we see this benefit with the 30 minutes per day or 150 minutes per week. And it seems that you may lose it here, but you have to look at this statistical error. So but there are several other studies, that big studies that have come out during the past few years. And I was actually just at a council in Denmark, and we went through the literature, and our conclusion was, no, there is no limit. I mean, we had been fearing that there was a limit where too much exercise became a risk factor, but we can't conclude that. This is despite the fact that high volume exercise will increase the risk of atrial fibrillation, but without any other risk factors, it does not seem to that this increased risk of atrial fibrillation is linked to an increased risk of mortality. I think this is quite interesting. I could also say that if we look at Olympic people who have been participating in the Olympic Games during the past 100 years, then they have a long lifespan. It doesn't seem that there is an increased risk for premature mortality. So this is how I see it. I don't know if you agree.
Well, one of the things, of course, is that if you mention the Olympics, of course, those people, they have a very long period in training and increasing training. If you try to mimic the training amount of Olympians becoming from sedentary, you, I would say, luckily become injured before there are other risk factors that appear. I think so. It's a very awkward sentence, but luckily you get injured and you won't go into that total amount of training stages, because of course over a whole career of an athlete it's a lot, but it's gradually increasing. And I think that is also one of the important messages here. If you increase things too fast, that could be maybe the risk of injury, and maybe not on the metabolic side, but probably that would be a nice study to do. Scott was impressed by the diaphragm and the importance also there from the mitochondria. It's almost logical, I would say, because it's a muscle that has to work all the time. So it needs to be very, very good in mitochondrial function. But what if by the mechanical ventilation, you of course don't ventilate yourself anymore, and there's also the, let's say, call it neuromuscular steering of the diaphragm that is not really present anymore. Could that, let's say, neuromuscular aspect also play a role in the fast atrophy?
Yeah, so that's a great question. We don't think this plays a critical role in the first 12 to 24 to 48 hours. But there's no question in prolonged weeks to months of mechanical ventilation that neural drive to the diaphragm is declining. Studies have suggested that from a variety of models in limb muscle, that we predict it's the same in the diaphragm. But the most the rapid contractile dysfunction and atrophy, I doubt that this is a neural link. It just occurs too quickly.
Okay, thank you. I see no more questions popping up.
I would thank you. Can I ask a question?
Of course.
Thank you, Scott. Really impressive data. Wonderful. So what I was curious about, so you can, as you said, you can lose the effect of exercise. So if you did train, you can lose. But how long time will this, what is it? What are we talking about? Days or weeks or months or years? Do you know that, or is it all based on animal models here?
Yeah, it's all based on animal models. And we don't know in the diaphragm. We've never tried to do that detraining experiment. If you look at the half-life of HSP72 and skeletal muscle, you know, the pineal who did the experiment, it's somewhere in the range of about 5 days.
Five days.
you would predict that the protection would be lost as a function of the decline in the abundance of HSP 72.
Yeah.
That would be my prediction. I've never done that experiment, but.
No more burning questions in the audience or with the two speakers?
We have met before. So.
Of course, that's always the case. If not, then I think the first thing I have to do is to thank you both for these very impressive talks. I'm again glad to having organized this exchange symposium. We always try to have top level speakers, and this year again we succeeded, so thank you very much. I also want to thank the organizers of European College of Sports Science, because it's a hell of a job, I think, to switch to online pool size, and having this organized, and also the preparation for this talk. We were all very say confident that it would work, and it worked very well. So thank you also for the organizers. Thank you for the audience for being there, and see you all hopefully in three dimensions at the next conferences at ACSM or European College of Sports Science. Thank you very much.
Goodbye, everybody. Thank you very much for allowing me to take part. I enjoyed it.
Thank you very much. And also thank you, Romain, for taking you upon this task as running the ACSM ECSS Exchange Symposium. Important work.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.